Hi, welcome to Teardown Tuesday. We've got another interesting bit of kit here from the professional audio industry. I like this kind of stuff because it's not something that you get to see every day, and it's not a piece of consumer item that's built down to a price. These are very expensive bits of kit, and they've basically spared no expense inside these things. They're built for reliability, built for quality, not trying to meet some stupid consumer price point. So we've seen this previously in the Sony video matrix switcher special effects thingamabob, which I'll link in here if you haven't seen it. And it was like superbly engineered and just a massive bit of systems engineering. I expect this one to be quite similar. What is it? It's a Yamaha DME 32 or digital mixing engine. I don't know huge amount about the professional audio industry. What I do know is that it's basically a digital equivalent to one of those analog mixing desks. You've seen those huge analog mixing desks with hundreds of dials and knobs and everything for every bandwidth and every input, and they mix all the signals in the analog domain. Well, this does basically the same thing, but does it in the digital domain. In fact, you can actually get a proper mixing desk which hooks up to this, but it's all digital. So instead of using like analog pots and op amps, they're actually they're motor controlled. I think they can like move on their own, and it's basically a digital input to drive this. But this is the thing that has the analog to digital converters and the digital analog converters in it, and you can basically do exactly the same thing or more than you could with the analog mixing desk. And well, you know, your aficionados out there might prefer the analog sound, but if you want all your special effects, then these sorts of digital mixing engines, because they're DSP based, can do basically anything you want. They can correct, they can mix signals together, they can equalize bandwidths, you can put in filters, you can correct for speaker and room acoustics, and it's just endless what you can do once you sample stuff in. So we expect some high-end analog to digital converters in here, digital analog converters, very well made as well. And well, let's check it out. And thank you very much for Matt for donating this thing for the Teardown. Matt is the one who just bought in that 3D 360 degree camera that I used to shoot, that you just saw previously. So thank you very much, Matt. You know what we say here on the EEB blog, don't turn it on, take it apart. Here's a close-up of the front paddle, and as you can see, very spartan. We've got a couple of digits here telling us which scene we're on, whatever that means, configuration, the scene. I don't know, it seems to be all about the scenes. A encoder knob for the data, and setting parameters, components, values, what sample rate we're working at, 48 kilohertz or 44.1 kilohertz, whether or not it's locked. Oh, emergency warning, Will Robinson. I don't know, you know, the global data clock got lost or something. A couple of controls to set things, and scene recalls. So it's all about scenes, and looks like you can save stuff to PC MCIA card. Yes, this one's a little bit old school, but as you can see, clearly not designed to be like operated from the front panel, designed to be operated from either the optional digital mixing desk and or a PC of some description, something like that. And on the back here, we can see that it's a modular slot-based system. There's four slots here. We've only got three populated, but this is a 24-bit 96 kilohertz analog to digital converter output, and then we've got two input 2/8 channel input modules here. So obviously you can configure them with whatever input and output you need. Curiously, they've got TRS jacks here and a D25 for the analog output. So that's, you know, rather interesting, rather than your XLR, your traditional XLR connectors and things like that. So I'm not sure what's going on there from a system point of view. We've got external word clock here. This is for the converter, so you can actually synchronize all of your system to the one sample clock. And it's got MIDI in and out, PC control, of course, serial port here. You can go RS422 or RS
232, and that you saw that USB connector on the front as well. This hooks, you can use either of these to hook up to a PC. It comes with, or it might, I don't know, you might have to pay extra for it, whatever, but it has Windows-based mixing software, so you can do all the digital mixing, just, you know, looks and feels just like a real analog mixer, but controlled by a PC. And then we've got cascade in and out. You can cascade multiple units together for however many channels you want. And these Phoenix connectors here, these are all general purpose I/O, so it allows them, you know, you can control whatever it is, you know, stage equipment, all sorts of rack gear or whatever, basically whatever your imagination can think up here in your live scenarios, because these are typically used in, like, in the field for setting, like, a, you know, a concert performance or something like that. So they're going to ship one of these around in a Pelican case or something like that. Then all the roadies have to, you know, set it all up on site and things like that, possibly with PC control and or a digital mixing desk, and then wire everything in, and they'd have, you know, all things pre-configured for what that particular band's requirements are. So here we go, let's crack the lid, and what I expect in here is lots of huge big ass boards. It's going to be all surface mount. This is not ancient. This is not like 80s or 90s or even 90s stuff. This is I believe like early 2000s or something like that. So it should be reasonably modern. Possibly lots of ASIC stuff like we saw in the Sony video mixer, for example. So, you know, Yamaha are a pretty big company. They might roll their own chips, because they did back in the day, and, you know, it wouldn't surprise me that they still do that sort of thing. So, and I expect no corners to be cut. They're going to be using quality caps. They're going to be using real expensive high performance analog devices, maybe ADCs and DACs, for example, in the boards. Oh, I probably could have just taken the boards out there and had a look at those first. But anyway, let's see all this. Lots of system engineering goes into this thing. It's going to be enormous. I don't think it's just going to be like one simple microcontroller and woohoo! Look at that. Jackpot in like Flynn. And it seems I've lost my little black pointer, so I have to use the screwdriver. People will complain. Check out this. Wow, this is a huge top board. There's going to be, there might be another board underneath, but the modules actually plug in the back. Not sure how far they actually go into it. Got our power supply over here. We'll check a look at, take a look at. But look at this. Yamaha. Everything's Yamaha. Now, I might be able to Google those and maybe get some of the numbers, but obviously we've got some memory here. These are going to be like custom ASICs designed by Yamaha specifically for this. I'm pretty sure we've got an off-the-shelf processor, which we'll take a look at, but these might be doing, these are, you know, the DSP, the switching, who knows? They've got a lot of memory surrounding them, so not sure what's going on there, but it looks like all of our inputs are coming from over here. If we have a look at that, this ribbon cable down, there's actually a whole bunch of ribbon cables. I'll show you here in a minute. There's four bunches of ribbon cables. They're all coming through here. We've got are they some sort of buffer, something like that. Anyway, into all these are doing all your heavy duty processing and things like that. You might notice a few bodge wires in here. Look at that, a couple of green ones going over there, big black one running all the way down here, nicely daubed down like that. Look at that, another one in here. This is very common in this sort of pro gear. They design these boards. It takes a massive many years to design these things, and countless engineer hours go into this, and you might find an issue when they write down the track that they go, we don't want to re-spin the whole board, what the hell, because we don't make these in huge volume, so let's just put a bodge wire in there and she'll be right. And they can, you know, do these professional mods in there, and it's very common in high-end professional gear like this. So what would you have here? I don't know, your guess is as good as mine. These monsters over here could be the main DSP, perhaps all the like all sort of like the high end heavy lifting stuff done over here. These seem more like individual filters. I mean, we've got sort of, you know, 10 of them there. All of our inputs seem to be like 8 channel cards and things like that. I don't know, each one of these could be doing programmable filter function that you download to them. Who knows, they could have a specific use. They could have pre-programmed low pass, high pass filtering or something like that in them. Who knows. But what is very clear is that this board is almost entirely digital. It's, as I said, all the there's 4 ribbon cables coming over here from the module, so all the analog to digital and digital to analog conversion all done on those plug-in modules as you'd expect. So this is all just the digital DSP processing. And then we've got ourselves the main processor here, which is a Hitachi SH2, one of these Super H processors. But Hitachi, of course, are being bought out by Renesas, so now they, I think they still do this part, or you know, a variation of it. They still do the Super H processor. The reason for all the different footprints here is so that during development, it's not like, you know, another chip plugs into there, but they can actually plug in a real-time in-circuit emulator in there, for example, and actually emulate this chip, emulate this processor, and do all sorts of in-circuit serial emulation, in-circuit emulation, and all sorts of that jazz during development. But during production, they don't need it anymore. And next to that, we've got ourselves an Altera Max CPLD there. It's a silkscreen with the model number DME32, so pre-programmed by Altera, perhaps. Now, this is interesting. We see this at multiple points around the board. This anchor screw here, mounted to the metal chassis, has its own isolated copper on there, but the designers have left in little exposed pads where somebody at the production stage, when they've assembled this board, has gone, we want to connect the chassis through to the main ground on here, so let's connect these points up by adding these solder blobs. And this is at in several locations around this board, every mounting point, in fact. You can see the digital I.O. at the back here has its own separate ground plane, and you'll notice those exposed copper pads there, 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 which they haven't joined up. They haven't joined the ground at that point. Look all the way along, see them? There, there, there. Where does it join? Bingo! Right at the end over here. So the designers have gone, well, let's solve our grounding issues at the final stage. Depending on maybe, you know, system or customer or model requirements, we may actually have to join the grounds at different points. So maybe the designers were hedging their bets here. Okay, let's figure out later where our optimum star grounding point is going to be. Is it here? Is it going to be in the center of the board here, for example, over here? Or should we just join them all together like that later in production? So maybe they were hedging their bets. Maybe it's something to do with different model or, you know, customer requirements, configurations, something like that perhaps. And check out this digital cascaded input and output around here. Check out these Murata. These look for all the world like the designator's almost a dead giveaway, EM. Now, these are almost certainly some sort of EMI filter, for example, some sort of, you know, network array, sort of 8-channel kind of thing, handling 8 channels a pop. So they're really serious about EMC on these things, and you can see over here as well, look, EM as well, not the same networks, but obviously they're doing a couple of signals here for the PC. This is like the RS422485 and the COM interface there. So yeah, they're putting some filtering on the line. They've got it also here over here, little EM filter for the input and output data clock. And aha, I was kind of right. I looked up these YSS910S's, and these are, yes, custom LSIs, large-scale integration, or ASIC, or whatever you want to call it. Basically, ASIC chips from Yamaha, and they claim that they're the world's first 44-bit DSPs. So each one of these chips is an individual DSP like that. So they've got 10 DSPs all around here, all with their own local memory as well. And they're upside down, so all the electrons are going to fall out. Oops. And these other three bigger ones, YSS 904Fs, all I can get on those at the moment is that they are, once again, DSPs. So they've got an additional three DSPs, and it looks like they are sort of coupled into these. You can see some of the routing there, perhaps, like it's, yeah, it's got to be going over here, and yeah, they eventually sort of cross-coupling these DSPs, however they're doing that. But yeah, this thing is all DSPs, as we expected. So you can probably guess that this Super H processor up here is just running things like the LCD and the user interface and, you know, all that sort of miscellaneous control stuff and PC control and cascading control and all that sort of stuff. I don't think it's doing any DSP at all, because the whole idea of this thing is that it all does DSP directly in dedicated hardware. And that's the thing, you might be wondering, well, why don't you just do this in a PC these days? Well, maybe they do, but when you've got so many channels like this, having dedicated DSPs in here, it's all about latency and throughput and all that sort of kind of stuff. You try and put it through the one PC processor, even if it's, you know, the top-of-the-line Intel i7, it's probably going to choke. You could have latency issues or whatever, interrupt issues. You don't want any of that. You want dedicated hardware like this. It's just much nicer to do it in dedicated hardware. You get a guaranteed known result, no issues whatsoever. It just works and will always work. By the way, if you're wondering what that Altera Maxa CPLD is doing, I see a couple of traces sort of running up here towards the Cascade circuitry, so maybe it's like the dedicated Cascade controller for just syncing together multiple units, perhaps. I'm liking the look of that crystal from NDK down there, of course, made in Japan. All of this stuff made in Japan. What are you talking about, Doc? All of this stuff's made in Japan. And there you go, that's probably like a PLL for the crystal or something, perhaps. I, you know, just by the locality of it, really. And this could be like a TXO or something, a temperature-compensated crystal oscillator. Once again, custom ASIC by Yamaha. They just do all their own silicon. Absolutely amazing. And the only hint of any sort of like analog-y or power stuff on here is this package. Check out the power pins there. They've got the large pin either side acting as a, so this is some sort of large current device, by its proximity to this ribbon cable, which looks like it's going towards the 7-segment LED display on the front. I'm going to say that's some sort of high current LED display driver. And it's interesting to note that this DSP here has its own 40 megahertz processor. Look at that, all nicely isolated there. So is this the master clock for all of the rest of these, all 10 of those DSPs? And a dead giveaway that this board is digital only. This is the only input power connector, 5 volts and 3.3 volts. Thank you very much. Now let's cast our eye over this power supply. I think we might find a interesting thing or two in here. I love this switch on the front panel. Look, got its own board. It's got big, beefy, dedicated connectors going down in there. Oh, love it. That's just a beautiful power switch. Spared, no expense there whatsoever. I'm seeing HRC input fuses, big ass MOV there. We've got big ass filtering right there. We've got a ferrite clamp on there just to take the edge off the RF on this thing. And, well, it's looking very good. Can't see the brand of those caps, but you can bet your bottom dollar they're going to be the best ones you can get. And here's something very nice. I like this. Look at this power supply module. Instead of just putting these, I presume, output power transistors / regulators here, instead of just having them on the board freestanding with little individual heat sinks, no, they've taken the whole back chassis like this, the whole back frame of the power supply, actually bent and cut that out and then bent it in and used that as a heat sink and mounted them on the bottom, soldered them through the bottom of the board. Somebody was really thinking there, use this whole thing as a heat sink, because this thing does not have a fan in it. So it's, you know, it's whisper quiet, and it, you know, that's how they can probably get away with it. Not sure how much power this thing uses. We might be able to see if we have a look down in the label down there. Can't quite see it at the moment, but that is just, yeah, that's just very nice indeed. And just small touches, like instead of just having this cable here flap around in the breeze, put a little cable tie on it there and clamp it to the ferrite case. Ah, gorgeous. And here we go, I've swung out this power supply, it's still connected. Look at the isolation here between all the input. We've got ourselves the common mode chokes. Look at the input filter in here. Just absolutely brilliant. They're monster common mode chokes, monster filtering, all properly rated. And then these transformers would be the duck's guts as well, no doubt. And sorry you can't see that, but these are Nippon Chemicon, of course, one of the best in the industry. 105 degrees C rated. Thank you very much. So obviously very carefully chosen. They would be, you know, the right particular model with the right ESR, with the right brand. It looks like they've got many in parallel over here. I don't like the fact that they are sort of flapping around in the breeze. They did put some Celastic on the base of these ones here, but these ones over here are flapping around, but geez, I think I'll forgive them for that. But no dodgy caps in this thing whatsoever, and yeah, no shortage of output filtering. Actually, if you can just see that, this looks to be a Nayuta brand, so it looks like they have shopped this out, but also made in Japan, and you can probably see the various voltages and currents on there. Not sure of the overall power, you'd have to add them all up. And by my calculations, that's a 48 watt output power supply. And let's see if we can remove this entire top board, shall we? We've disconnected all the cables, taken off all the jacks at the back, and it's not trivial, but ta-da! It's out! Beauty! Hey, look at that! Not a huge amount more in here. So I just got one baseboard down on the bottom. It's just got one main ASIC down in there. That's not a Yamaha, that's just an off-the-shelf kind of like a PC type chipset. This is the PCMCA and USB board. As you can see, the USB connector is right down there going to the front panel. Got a old-school PCMCA adapter, and that all goes over via these ribbon cables here. Not else much doing. Got some power coming in there. And then the rest of it, as you can see, the four main ribbon cables all connecting through to this motherboard at the back here, which then connects our four slots with their own card cages. We'll take those out separately, and there's one little board on the back for the digital I.O. And that digital I.O. board's worth a squiz. Check this out. Once again, they've got some very nicely bodged resistors on there. Look, they're putting tape under there so they don't short anything out. Individually sleeved these resistors on the top here and then bust them all together like that. So obviously they're doing some sort of a pull up there because it's all common, so they decided, oops, yeah, let's not re-spin that board, let's just mod them. Although a really small board like that, I don't know why you wouldn't have respun it, because that's a fair bit of manual labor on there. So maybe it is cheaper to just to have somebody, you know, if you've got a huge stock of these boards, maybe, yeah, you don't want to scrap them. So yeah, maybe it is cheaper just to get them to redo that. You're paying some assembler's time, you know, 10 minutes per board or something like that, instead of A, scrapping all the boards, B, the design effort to redesign it, C, to all the parts to re-spin it. So, yeah, okay. And there's the entire backside of the board, mostly just bypass caps and a few miscellaneous diodes and resistors and things like that they couldn't populate on the top here. But we got one bodge there, and we have another very interesting, and that's a complete bodge board right under the main processor. So yeah, I'm not sure what the go is there, but check this out. They've actually sucked out, have they actually sucked out the solder that was left in these pads from this in-circuit emulator thing, sucked that out to get your wires through to the other side of the board. And that's actually not uncommon actually to use. And in fact, one of the advantages of using large pads and large vias, for example, is that you can actually fit mod wires to go from one side of the board to the other, because that's a very common requirement when you mod boards like this. How do you get a wire from a trace on the bottom of the board to the top? Sometimes, yeah, it has to be really ugly. Even you've got to drill a hole in there, and if it's multi-layer, well, that can be a real pain in the ass. You don't want to short out your inner layers. That's bad if you've got like 5 volts and ground like this one is. You can tell by all the dark all the darkness under there. That obviously this is a four layer board, so it's got one big copper plane in there for your ground, and also it's not going to be three layers. They're always like an even number, almost always an even number of layers. So they're going to have four. So they're going to have the power and ground planes in there. So if you drill through, just be careful. You might short out your power planes. That will ruin your day because you can get burrs between the layers. Anyway, very common to have to get them. Like sometimes you might, you know, if you're desperate, you have to run, say, a mod wire. Oh, I need this track and I need to go, you know, I can bodge it into this track. I need to run the wire all the way over here, wrap it around the edge of the board and go all the way back over the top. And that's a pain. If you can find a shortcut to just jumper under like that. But that is very nicely done. I mean, that's, you know, about as professional as you can get if you're doing mods like this. And you can see the same rear panel ground split here and those little joining traces there. And where does it join? Where does it join? Where does it join? No surprises for guessing exactly where it joins on the other side. There's a little solder blob. And here's the 24-bit analog to digital converter board, 96 kilohertz. Let's take a look at it. Pretty simple. We've got a secondary daughter board up here. So these are our, I don't know how many channels. I'm going to presume it's maybe eight channels. And there's four output buffers there. They're going to have identical circuitry underneath there, so I won't bother taking that off. We can see we've got, I can see that they're JRC, Japan Radio Corp op amps, so we'll take a closer look at those, get the exact model number. Interestingly, it's all through hole, it's, you know, mostly like through hole resistors and caps and things with surface mount chips, so that's a bit unusual. Are they gilding the lily there in terms of, oh, these are lower noise, these suckers, than what they can get in SMD? Anyway, dual side load, which is a bit interesting. And then they've bent all the leads over and put the silk screen on the bottom. Anyway, very professionally done. I got no issues with that at all. It looks quite nice. And we've got ourselves a Xilinx FPGA by the looks of it. No, that's not an FPGA, it's an in-system programmable CPLD, the XC9572. It's only got 1500 gates, like 72 macro cells. Not a huge deal. It's just doing some glue logic for the interface stuff for our digital to analog converters. There they are. So they must be, well, there's only four of them. We've got some, looks like these are probably buffers. I can take a look at those numbers, are a bit hard to read there. So is this is almost like it's got some conformal coding on this board, actually. Anyway, these are just going to be buffers, I think. Yeah, I checked. They're very hard to read the numbers on there, but they're 74HCT245. So yeah, just buffers. Aha, these are Wolfson ones, WM8740s. I'll link in the data sheet down below so you can take a look. These are stereo DACs. So we've got four stereo DACs on here. So we've got eight, so basically only four stereo channels for this whole thing, or eight channels total. I'm not sure, I don't know if they're running stereo pairs here. It could just be eight channels or however you want to configure it. Anyway, they are very high performance, you know, like, you know, world-class 24-bit audio DACs, 192 kilohertz, now owned by Cirrus Logic. Wolfson got bought out there, but... And it turns out you can still buy these puppies. They're, of course, from made by Cirrus Logic now, but they're still under the same part and the same Wolfson part number, about $4 each in 2000 quantity. And then the output of our DAC goes, there's probably some filtering in there, goes to, aha, Analog Devices OP275. That's the 275G. And this is a bit of a special puppy. It's specifically designed for the, you know, as an audiophile class op amp. 0.006% distortion, massive 9 megahertz bandwidth, and it's got, in quote marks, excellent sonic characteristics. Ooh. And it's got a special front end. It uses a Butler front end, which is a combination of JFETs and bipolar. So yeah, super duper special. Ooh, we are not worthy. So it seems like they're running some sort of active, you know, filter around there. And then the, so we go from our DAC to and some sort of active filter in, maybe some sort of bandpass filter, and then running into our output driver. No surprises for finding the Japan Radio Corp 4580s in there. They're, you know, once again, audio class output driver op amps. You know, 0.005% distortion, all the usual business. And check it out, you don't see Sanyo caps that often. And they're just way off the board there, flapping around in the breeze. That's a bit how you're doing. But the reason they've done that, you can see that they've got formed legs, so they're designed to stand off the board like that. And then here's our analog to digital converter board. So we've got our eight input channels there with our TRS jacks, and no surprises for finding exactly the same audio grade op amp OP275s in there that we had before. So we've got some, so these are our input amplifier, got some filtering happening there, and look, each channel has a selectable gain, either plus 24 dB or plus 4. So I guess they're, you know, they're user adjustable. You can just pull these out and set whatever input gain you like. And once again, they're running just the secondary daughter board there to get the extra four channels on top there. So yeah, exactly the same circuitry underneath. You can see the switches as well. And then we've got the output of our input amp going into, surprisingly, a pretty Joe Bloggs dual op amp. Once again, Japan Radio Corp 2115s, and they're really nothing special at all. So they're doing like a two-stage filter in there, high pass and low pass perhaps. Well, they do look like identical stages just based on the layout of the components. So yeah, maybe they're doing a cascaded filter there perhaps, and going into our analog to digital converter. Let's check it out. And once again, no surprises for finding Cirrus Logic in here. No, these aren't Wolfson ones, these are Cirrus Logic design and branded CS5360s. Once again, 24-bit, you know, really high performance audio class Delta Sigma analog to digital converters. So no worries whatsoever. And then we've got those just going into some, once again, HC245s, HC138s, so we've just got some decoders and some buffers there. That's about all she wrote. So nothing fancy on these boards at all. They've just got their basic functionality, ADC or DAC, and some glue and interface logic, and that's about all she wrote. No components on the bottom of this sucker. Notice all the grounds separate, of course. They're going to design this properly. They're not going to do a real high-performance industrial product, audio-grade thing like this, and goof up all the grounding and not have separate grounds for each channel coming back to some star point. So, yeah, they're going to be getting that right. Bet your bottom dollar. So there you go. That's a teardown of a professional Yamaha digital mixer, as opposed to one of these analog ones, and yet very professionally designed and manufactured, as you'd expect. They really, you know, spared no expense in these things. I'm not sure how much it's worth brand new, but they are, you know, if you have to ask the price, you can't really afford one. They're designed for big, you know, bands and, you know, touring things, and, you know, or even studios or something like that. Really kind of like world-class stuff. This one is obsolete now. I think there is an upgraded model to it, but all of the custom DSP processing in there, absolutely incredible stuff. Imagine the amount of engineering design hours which went into making this. Absolutely phenomenal. So I hope you enjoyed that, and if you liked it, please give it a big thumbs up on YouTube, because that always helps a lot. And if you want to discuss it, jump on over to the EEV blog forum, or leave YouTube or blog comments, and follow me on Twitter and all that stuff, but not on Facebook, because I don't give a toss about Facebook, but I do tweet a lot. So yeah, people do ask, do I have a Twitter account? Yeah, bet your ass I have a Twitter account. And yes, No, I don't have somebody who sends tweets for me. You know, I'm not one of those celebrities it's not like Dave's over here. David 2's laughing there behind me. No, I'm not going to get him to, like, send my tweets now. My tweets are my own. And, yes, they're not always about electronics. So, Anyway, as always, high-res teardown photos available on eevblog.com if you want to take a look at those. Catch you next time.